In this video, we review our work on an implantable brain-computer interface for neuroprosthetic-enabled volitional hand grasp restoration in a patient with spinal cord injury. We'll review the importance of brain-computer interfaces and how we implemented this system in both the laboratory and home environment. To underscore the importance of this work, it is important to note that stroke, spinal cord injury, and multiple sclerosis are the leading causes of paralysis, and that paralysis results in a devastating outcome for patients and their families. Because no cure exists for spinal cord injury, any improvement in function or independence could significantly improve the personal, medical, financial, and social burdens on this population. Considering where research should focus, surveys administered to patients with spinal cord injury have revealed what patients would want most if given the opportunity to regain control of a function lost due to injury. Among patients with quadriplegia, restoring arm and hand function is a top priority. Brain-computer interface research has climbed in the last 20 years, in part to find ways to restore lost neurologic function. By recording data from the brain, brain-computer interfaces have enabled patients with paralysis to control computers, exoskeletons, and improve communication. Seeking to build a fully implanted brain-computer interface for motor restoration, we utilized event-related desynchronizations to drive motor output. For neural data acquisition, we took advantage of a research deep brain stimulation system that allowed for both sensing and stimulation capabilities. We connected the pulse generator to two four-contact strip electrodes and placed them over the dominant sensory motor cortex. The recorded neural signals could then be decoded to serve as a control input to a wireless arm orthosis, which delivered transcutaneous electrical stimulations to the muscles of the forearm to reanimate hand opening and closure. With this plan, we initiated a clinical trial to identify candidate patients for brain-computer interface implantation and control. This is a sagittal MRI of our first study patient, who was 21 years old at the time of enrollment. The patient was classified as a C5 Asia A spinal cord injury after being involved in a motor vehicle accident at the age of 17. We use functional magnetic imaging and diffusion tractography for surgical planning to target optimal electrode placement. Areas in green were active as a patient voluntarily moved their proximal shoulder, whereas areas in red were active during imagined right hand movement. Both activities encompass the cortical spinal tracts and thus motor cortex. These pre-surgical tests allowed us to stereotactically plan a small craniotomy, as shown, to place the electrodes. After implantation and time for recovery, the neural implant was first optimized by selecting electrode pairs to sense event-related desynchronization. By presenting rest and move prompts to the patient while instructing them to relax or imagine moving their dominant hand, we were able to detect the desynchronization within the frequency domain of the recorded signals. We developed a decoder to use these signal features to predict the patient's volitional command to the hand. The raw ECOG from a time channel is shown above during rest and move. The power spectrum is computed between 0 and 100 Hz, and the data was broken down into 8 frequency bins. The average power in each bin was then computed and used to create features for rest and move. The features from channel 1 and 3 were put together with the power from channel 2 and 4 to create a feature vector. A total of at least 60 trials were then put together for training many different classifiers. The bag tree classifier performed the best with a median accuracy of approximately 90%. This performance remains stable across 21 sessions as shown by the box plot on the bottom right. To determine functional outcomes, we performed a series of functional tasks that required the patient to use the system to grasp an object and move it to a target. After an attempt, the distance between the center of the target and the object was measured as shown. This was repeated 20 times each session to calculate a trial score and an accuracy measurement for the trial. This was repeated every day for 10 weeks to monitor progress, which showed improvement in the patient's accuracy for this task over time.
To deliver this system to the patient's home, we used a custom 3D printed casing to house a computer and battery pack to the back of the patient's wheelchair for mobility. We also developed a mobile phone interface so the patient or their caregiver could configure the system settings, change between BCI functions, and collect data from the home. These spectral plots show 3 to 4 weeks worth of data collected at home to demonstrate that event-related desynchronizations are still detectable from the home environment and can be used as a control signal to drive the mechanical orthosis. To decode event-related desynchronizations in the home, we developed a new decoding architecture that was optimized by the 4 hyperparameters shown here, and the performance of this decoder sat at around 90% after training. Immediately after deployment, the family sent us these videos demonstrating the ability to pick up some common objects, including their headphones and a brush used to brush their beard or hair. With this work, we've shown that event-related desynchronization can be used reliably in the home as a control signal for assistive devices, and that event-related desynchronization may be applied to restore other functional modalities. These signals have remained stable since the first training session, and using a fully implanted device has allowed us to collect data remotely outside of the laboratory environment. Thank you for listening to a summary of our work, and we'd be happy to discuss any questions or comments you may have.